Here we are. My name is Tom and this is my final video on special relativity. Level 34C, the twin paradox, the most famous thought experiment in special relativity. It's been done by many others. There are like hundreds of videos out there. And what I tried to add was the real world perspective on this twin paradox as well, and added three levels of complexity. And this is the C level. This is the most complex one. But I will promise I will be gentle. I'm in a very good mood. This is the last one. Let's go. The twin paradox. For those who have never heard of the twin paradox, here's a primer. Two of them. One of them goes into a rocket ship, flies away, comes back to Earth. The average speed on the rocket, 60% of the speed of light. How long was the rocket away? Well, let's say 120 seconds on an Earth clock, or maybe 120 days, weeks, months, years, whatever. 120 times of units. And then the clock in the returning spaceship will not have ticked 120, but only 96. Meaning the twin on the rocket aged less. Yes, if it would have been 120 months, the difference between those two twins would be 24 months, which is 2 years. So they were both the same age. One goes off in a rocket ship, comes back, and now that person is 2 years younger than the one who was on Earth all the time. But the one in the rocket tells us, no. I was not moving at all in my record. I saw planet Earth moving away from me and coming back to me. And therefore time dilation. And therefore your clock is running slow. And therefore you age 2 years less than me. I'm not sure if that person would be happy about it. You know, most of us try to stay and look as young, as fresh as we can. But you know, the person could be right. And this is a really difficult paradox. Puzzled many for years. Great minds in physics and mathematics. What's going on here? Let's dive in. Here they are, the triplets. Yes, oh yeah, yeah, I'm skipping a step. I turned it into a triplet paradox, which makes it really easy because now we can use special relativity. In the A level, I explained that if you do the twin paradox using special relativity, you're cheating a little bit. But if you turn it into a triplet problem, you're not cheating. And that's what we're doing here. We have one of the triplets staying on Earth, one of them is in a rocket that's red, and one of them is in a green rocket that flies from right to left. We see the tip of the green rocket in the image. They all have their clocks. The one on Earth has a blue clock, the one on the red rocket has a red clock, and the one on the green rocket has a green clock. And as a bonus, because you never see this in those videos, in these kinds of videos, the one on Earth is taking a telescope and is watching the red clock in the red rocket and the green clock in the green rocket and tries to make sense of it all. Here's the animation. And okay, before I start, they have to sync these clocks sometimes. So the red rocket, as soon as it is exactly in the same place as Earth, then Earth and the red rocket sync their clocks to zero. And when the red rocket and the green rocket pass each other, they're both flying at the same speed, 60% of the speed of light, then they sync their clock as well. Let's see what happens. This is what's going on. Mind-blowing stuff, this. There's so much going on here. Earth clock has done its 120 seconds. The red clock and the red rocket has slowed down. Time dilation, 96 seconds. But because the red clock never returned to Earth, how can we know if it's really at 96? Because it's way out there. Well, the green rocket, which was flying at exactly the same speed as the red rocket, brought that information back home because it synced right in the middle of the animation. When the Earth clock was at 60 seconds, then the green and the red rocket were on top of each other. The green one took a picture of the clock and the red rocket, made sure that his clock was set to the same second, and we know that the green and the red dials having the same pace. We know this for true because they have the same speed. So the green rocket brought the information back home. So the twin on Earth is telling us the truth. The clock in the rocket slows down, and a person in that rocket ages less from our perspective on Earth. That's the truth. Though it's not a paradox anymore. No, the twin or the triplet on Earth is the one who's right, and the triplet or the twin in the rocket is wrong. Then I added the telescope watching of the clocks, and there you saw, if you do the animation again or go back, that the red clock, as observed through a telescope on Earth, was spinning at half the speed of the Earth clock, and the green clock was spinning twice the speed, you know. And we've done this before. Go look at levels 27 and 28 for real world time dilation, real world length contraction, why I am adding the videotaping of these things, and also level 32. Where I did also real world stuff. But, you know, I can imagine that this is difficult if, it is incredibly complex. So what am I going to do now? I'm happy, you know, this is my final video, but not that I'm happy that to stop videotape, but it took me so much time. So let's see, what am I going to do? Oh, I'm going to do the Lorentz transformation. Yeah, so go back to level 27. So this is classic time dilation, right? The time of the red clock from the perspective on Earth, so T red comma perspective Earth, equals the time of the Earth clock, comma, perspective of Earth, divided by the Lorentz factor gamma, which in this case is, if you are flying at 60% of the speed of light, 1.25. I made so many videos about the Lorentz transformation. I'm expecting that you saw one of them, so I'm not going to explain the whole transformation thing here. This is the correction factor. We can do the same for the green clock, because the green clock is traveling also at 60% of the speed of light. So the time on the green clock from an Earth point of view is the time of the Earth clock from an Earth point of view divided by 1.25. This is classic time dilation, and we wanted to verify this by making the clock come back to us. And because we did it in a triplet experiment, none of the rockets were accelerating and none of the rockets were turning and decelerating. No, they were all at a constant velocity all the way throughout the experiment. And that's what we need in special relativity. Then we added the telescope things. If you go back to, I think level 32 is where I derived. I think I derived this already earlier at real world time dilation. Yeah, in level 27. It says so, Tom. Check level 27. The time of the red clock as observed through the telescope on Earth equals the time of the red clock from the perspective of Earth divided by 1 plus V. And V in this case is the speed of the red rocket from the perspective of Earth, which was 0.8C. If you do this, no, not 0.8, 0.6, they were at 60% of the speed of light. And it's not, it's V over C. Oh, I should have made it V over C, Tom. So we are dividing by 1 plus 0.6. So it's 1.6, right? T red Earth 1.6. Now we can substitute the classic time dilation formula for T red Earth. And then we get that the red clock, the time on the red clock as seen through the Earth telescope is the same as the clock on Earth divided by 2. Et voilà, that's what we saw. We saw the clock in the telescope spinning divided by 2, so it's always behind. Yeah, it was moving slower. Eh? So when the Earth clock has done one round, 60 seconds, then the red clock in the telescope has only gone 30 seconds. Really slow. Although the actual time difference is a factor of 1.25. Up there, right? Classic time dilation. Confusing stuff, this. We can do the same for the green telescope, the green clock looking through the telescope. Then we have to divide, because that's an object coming towards us. You have to divide not by 1 minus V, but 1 plus V. No, not by 1 plus V, but 1 minus V. So we get 1 minus 0.6 equals 0.4. And then we do the substitution again with classic time dilation. And we end up that the time on the green clock as seen through our telescope is the time on our own clock on Earth divided by 0.5. So it's spinning twice as fast as our clock. So that explains why the tempo, the pace was different in the telescope than the actual pace, which is dictated by classic time dilation. Now we need to take one more step to make it really accurate. Somewhere along the line, the green and the red clock synced, you know, right in the middle at 48 seconds in their world. At 60 seconds in our world, back on Earth, then they synced. So I need to add a syncing factor. The second equation needs to sync. So that's just what I'm doing here. I'm just taking the time of the green one through the telescope. I'm adding a constant, which I don't know yet, k. And the pace is still the same. The pace is Earth clock divided by 0.5. Well, let's put in an event, you know. If you want to find a factor unknown, put in events and see if you can come up with the factor. So, the moment they pass, the clock on Earth is at 60 seconds. The clock on the red rocket will be at 48. Therefore, that's because that's what classic time dilation tells us, right? Therefore, the person in the green rocket has to put his clock at 48 seconds when he passes the red rocket. So he does so. So we know that then the green clock will be at 48. So what will be the, what do we see, the, when do we see the red dial? It takes some time for the light from the red clock, or the green clock for that matter, when it is at 48 seconds, to travel back to Earth and hit our telescope. Well, if you do the math, you will see that that will be, well, we still don't know. No. That's not what I'm doing here. No, I'm just following the equations here. I'm saying T red Earth telescope is 48. So I'm seeing 48. So I see that they are at the same time. Then my clock on Earth will be at 96. That's what I'm doing here. Okay, cool. We also see green on 48 on Earth when it is 96 on Earth. Yeah, because they are in the same place. Both clocks are at the same place. So now we can solve the equation and we find that this constant K is 144. Okay, I'm fine with it. So the sync formula will be like this. Cool. Now you have all the information to go revisit the animation and see if you can truly understand and reproduce the results seen there. Is this it? No. I don't know when the last slide is coming. twin paradox using the space-time. So here we have classic time dilation. Here we have the real-world time formulas. We just derived this. Our event table, of course. Now you can see, we did it in the B level in the space-time diagram, but now you can also do it using the formulas, and you will see you will get the exact same results as we saw in the B level doing this using the space-time diagram. So the Earth clock and the red clock, they sync when the time on Earth on the Earth clock is zero, and then the red clock from the Earth perspective is also set to zero. Red will also be zero, of course. Green Earth will be zero. They are all zero. That's where the stuff starts. When they pass on Earth, it will be 60 seconds. On the clocks in the rockets, it will be 48. And when green comes back to Earth, our clock on Earth will be at 120 seconds. And the rocket clocks will be at 96. And then I said, try to do the telescope times as well for these three events. Well, the formula is just way up there, yeah? You can just punch it in. So you can be a daredevil, pause the video, run the numbers, hit play again, and see if you got it right, because I am going to reveal it right now. These are the numbers. There you go. I think this is it. I think this is the end. Let me check. I want to know for sure if this is the end. No, it's not. I was so nervous, I just hit the wrong button. I was so anxious, I made a mistake. So that's why you see this glitch in the video. No, we're not at the end. The final thing I want to tell you is, go see this website. I talked about it in level B. It's where I created a space-time diagram with the twin paradox for you to use. You can go there, change stuff, slide stuff around, change your perspective between the two rockets and the person on Earth. This is it. Now we are finally done. Thank you, thank you, thank you. I'm going to hit the button for the very last time. And I hope you enjoyed this journey as much as I did. There we go.